For this video, I've gathered questions from people like you who have left them in the comments of my videos, and I answer those questions to the best of my ability. Just remember that my answers are simply my opinions and don't let them bother you. So let's get to the first question. And the first question comes in from Cheryl. She says, I use the Sony a7R 4 and the A9 II. I splurged on the 400 f2.8. Congratulations, by the way. It's a fantastic lens. And I can barely handhold that for a second. I need my tripod for most situations. Are you handholding the Sony 600mm f4? I'm guessing you are, upper body strength and all that. Do you have situations in Costa Rica and in Florida where a tripod is possible? This was a great video. I do not have the opportunities to be out photographing often enough and find on my big trips when I do have the chance for my yearn for wildlife, I make mistakes that cannot be addressed for another year or two. That is why these videos are so helpful. Thank you. Thank you. I have plenty of workshops where you can actually use your tripod. In fact, I only have one where a tripod is not allowed, and that's because we go out on a boat and space is very limited, and that takes place in April, and it's for ospreys. But every other workshop I have, I actually highly encourage that you bring a tripod with you. I do shoot most of my stuff handheld. I've been doing it for a while, and I just feel that I can react faster without a tripod. With that said, there are plenty of times when I still do use my tripod. If it's really, really windy, I like to use a tripod because the bigger lenses are really hard to manage in a strong wind. And when I'm shooting video, I also like to shoot it from a tripod most of the time. So I suggest that you do use a tripod. It makes things a little bit easier. I just prefer most of the time not to. Question number two comes in from Mr. Bob 6425. Hello, Mark. Excellent video again. I was wondering, do you use the A7R 4 in APS-C mode when shooting these tiny birds from a distance? Look forward to more of your amazing videos. In my A7R 4 setup guide, I have set up one of the buttons to toggle between APS-C mode and full frame. I thought it was a really good idea, but I found that over time, I don't really switch to APS-C mode pretty much ever. I'll just take I like having the full frame space, and I'll just crop the images in post however I see fit. The only time where I really have found that APS-C crop mode to be super effective is when I'm actually shooting video. It's like having, you know, a little bit extra reach when you're doing video. So I still use it in that sense, but for stills, I just don't. For whatever reason, I like having the full frame, and even if my subject is kind of small in there, I'll still take it and then just crop it in post. And the next question is from Arabian Hunter. Mark, you are on top of my list for credible, trustworthy YouTuber and the best ever narrator and wildlife photographer. Are you planning and putting in a review for the Canon R5/6? Thanks, Philip the Arab. I would love to try the Canon R5. I don't know if I would try the R6. I think the R5 would be more geared towards me. So I've put a request in with my friends at B&H. So as soon as they send me one, I'll take it out and put it through its paces. From what I've seen, it looks to be an amazing camera, aside from the, I guess there's overheating issues, and now there's rumors that it might be hard to actually get one. I don't know if that's true, but either way, I would love to try that camera out, and yeah. And the next question is from Lenny Ferguson. Thanks for your videos, Mark. Bird in flight choice of body between A9 II or A7R 4. Thanks. I highly suggest that you have both those bodies, the A9 or the A9 II. I don't own the A9 II. I still have the original A9, I love it, and the A7 R 4. Having both of those bodies in your bag covers everything you could ever want to capture for bird in flight. There are different strengths and weaknesses between the two, and I've answered this in other videos, but I'll go ahead and answer it here too. I prefer the A9 in low light situations. The low light capability of that camera for bird in flight is amazing. High ISO, doesn't really matter on that camera. Also, if my subject is close enough and I need the absolute best, fastest speed, I'll choose the A9. If I have really good light and my subjects are a little bit further away, I'll choose the A7 R4 because the resolution on the A7 R4 is simply amazing, especially when you pair it with the Sony 600mm f4. It's like a whole different level of photography, almost like macro level detail on subjects that are really far away. And this question is from B. Pennenberg. What is the name of the photo printer shop in your area you mentioned in a recent video? The local print shop that I use for my metal prints like this, Their website is canvasandmetalprints.com. It's a family-owned business. They're right down the street from me, and their pricing on these metal prints is simply really good. It's cheaper than most places, and the quality is exceptional. So I highly recommend that little shop, canvasandmetalprints.com. No, this is not a paid advertisement. I just like the work that they do. They've done some incredible stuff, metal prints for me, and I really like it. It's actually printed on metal, and the back is really nice. It comes framed with this nice aluminum frame and an easy way to hang on the wall. They look great. The next question comes in from Mark and Sue Parker, and it's actually referencing the Nikon D850, and it's also referencing this hooded merganser duck picture here you see in the background. Hi, Mark. At 2:13, you show a great image of a duck in flight with a backdrop of reeds and trees. That's this image here. What AF mode were you using? I don't have any trouble getting the shot if the subject is in a blue sky, but really struggle when they are flying amongst trees, the sea, etc. Love the videos, and some of your images are breathtaking. Mark. With the Nikon DSLRs, I've had the best luck using group autofocus. I don't know what I actually used for that specific image, though. When I set up my D850, I have it set up with four different focus areas on different buttons. And I'll put a link to a video that shows how I set up my D850 here, right on the side or whatever, so you can go do that. And I also have a guide for the D850 as well that shows how I set it up and use it. But overall, I would use group for birds that are flying left or right, up or down. Just remember that group is supposed to prioritize whatever part of your subject is closest to you. So if a bird is flying left to right, it might prioritize a wingtip and not the face. You gotta keep that in mind. I also like D9 on the D850. D9 is a smaller dynamic area. As long as you can keep that small area on your subject, D9 does really well. I also use D25, and I also use single point, but single point would be more for birds that are perched or in some cover and I need like a laser pinpoint focus to go through all of the sticks and stuff. But I'm gonna guess, pretty sure, like 90% sure, that that shot you're referring to would have been with group autofocus. This question is from Sizzle Monkey Productions, and it also references the Nikon D850. Aloha, Mark. Chuck from Maui here. Another great video. Thank you for taking the time to produce this. I have a question. Do you know if there is a way to get the focus shift to go left or right, or does it always go from top to bottom? Thank you again for all you give to the community. So this refers to the D850's feature called focus shift, and I think you're thinking about this wrong. So from left to right should always be in focus because that's your plane of focus unless the lens you're using is soft on the edges. So the idea isn't to move from left to right, but to capture that small, thin plane of focus and move it from front to back and then layer all of those pictures on top of each other and in Photoshop, tell Photoshop to stack for focus. So then the entire picture from front to back is perfectly in focus. It's a cool feature. It looks kind of strange to me when you do it because the whole image is so high res from front to back and it's not like how I naturally see stuff. So it looks odd, but it's actually really cool because you can get some cool stuff. So no, there is no way to move it from left to right because from left to right should always be in focus because that's your plane of focus and you're just shifting the plane of focus forwards and backwards with that focus shift feature. The next question comes from rwilso15. Mark, great images, video, and storyline as usual. You inspired me to get up before dawn and go have a look for myself at the same location. I was using a D500 with a 500 f4 on a tripod, and I got some good shots, though not quite the Mark Smith League. I have to ask you, are you using AID noise or something similar in post? I was shooting auto ISO on the D500 and seeing ISO around 400 to 500, and my shots were way noisier than your Sony at ISO 2000, or is the Sony so much better at high ISO than Nikon? Please keep up the great work, Rob W. I do use Topaz AID noise as a permanent part of my workflow now. A good friend of mine, Michael, introduced it to me sometime last year, and I was hesitant to try it, but as soon as I did, I could not believe how good the results were. It just simply works. There are times when maybe it gives you some odd results, but it's only maybe 5% of the stuff that I've thrown at it where it gives me odd results, and I'll take the 95%. It's as simple as throwing it in that piece of software, and it just cleans the entire image. It's simply beautiful. I did a video on it when I first used it because I was so excited. I'll put a link to that video here. I highly suggest it. Topaz AI Denoise. It will alleviate any high ISO anxiety that you might have. And I know a lot of people actually have that. They're afraid, oh, I don't want to shoot this because the ISO is so high. But with certain cameras and with Topaz AI Denoise, there's no more high ISO anxiety.
And the next one comes from SH. Gorgeous. Guess these babies will be predated by something. He's referring to the Turn video I released just a little bit ago. Not sorry that you missed that, though. And a technical question. How do you keep the sand out of your gear?
This question actually refers to the video I posted about a week ago about the nesting lease terns. And there were predator birds there that were trying to pick them off. In fact, most of those predator birds were grackles, which was weird to me that the grackles would come in and try to take these little baby birds, but they were there. I'm sure there was other birds that were doing it as well. But the real question is, how do you keep sand out of your gear? That's a really good question, especially when you're laying down in the sand at the beach. Keeping it out of your gear is pretty simple. You know, just don't do any lens changes down there on the sand level. And if you do any lens changes, I'd like to turn the camera body so that the whole sensor is facing down. So if there is any sand in there, when you take the lens off, hopefully it falls down and not into the sensor. Keeping sand off of your gear when you're in a situation like that is almost impossible. You're gonna get sand everywhere. It gets on your hands, it gets on your gear, it gets in the cracks of the buttons, it gets everywhere. So when you come home, I suggest you use one of these rocket blowers and just give it a really good cleaning, especially around the lens mount before you take the lens off. So with the lens still on, just give it a good cleaning all the way around where that lens mount is and try to get all of that sand off the face of the camera, because that's usually when the problem happens. When you swap a lens out, sand will go down inside and you don't want sand inside your cameras.
And the last question comes from Audible Quest. Sir, I love your storytelling alongside these amazing images. Please tell us, how do you find your birds?
Finding birds, that can be really tricky. I'm a Florida native. It's kind of a rare thing. I was born and raised here, so I know the state pretty well, and I know certain areas very well because I've spent over 40 years out in the wild. I've been kind of chasing birds ever since I was a little kid, so it's just kind of second nature to me where all of the birds are in Florida. With that said, there are a lot of places that I've never been in Florida, and I have a lot of fans, friends, and people who will email me or call me or text me and tell me sometimes where there's really good stuff. Like, for instance, the Terns. I had a fishing guide from South Florida call me and tell me about it. And then I had a few friends, like the next day, call me and tell me about it as well. There's another really good resource that everybody can use, and that's eBird. You can check eBird.org. You can dig into there and you can find some really good stuff. You can see where people are reporting certain bird sightings all over the world, and it tells you like exactly where they saw the birds down with a little GPS and a map. So you can dig in there and you can actually have it send you daily or weekly digests of certain areas, counties, states, even certain birds, so that you can then actually find out where these birds are, where they're going, and you can kind of track stuff that way. And I highly suggest that. It takes a little bit of time, but it can be really helpful for finding maybe specific species that you're looking for. All right, that's it for the questions and answers. Thank you to everybody that submits those questions. I really appreciate it. And thank you for watching all of the videos and sharing them. I really appreciate that as well. It's great knowing that I have all of these people all over the world, and I think of all of you as my friends. It's an amazing experience. I can't thank you enough for all of the love and support you give me all of the time. Again, send more questions. I really enjoy actually this format. It's a lot of fun. If you thought this video was helpful, go ahead and share it. Click the thumbs up. If you had any questions about the questions or the answers, go ahead and leave them in the comments as well. And if you haven't subscribed yet, do that too. And until next time, I'll see you later.